Okay, so it's Friday, and I just got out of school, so I'm gonna be a sixth grader now. This is our mascot. He's a flashy duck with awesome hair. I wish I had his hair. But as you can see, we're just leaving, and we're ready for the adventure.
You guys, it's nice to be back home. So some of you guys might recognize this place as a place that I ventured around when I was a wee little one. I know I filmed quite a few little things here. One of them was Fight the Chase, where I fought my older brother in slow motion. Spoiler alert, I don't win. Jumping around in the water like Huck Finn, I had my hat on, my overalls and whatnot. But if you guys adventure down a little bit more, you will see that there is actually a power plant. I don't know if it's hydro energy or whatever it is, but they are dumping out their water waste, which kind of helps to create this little place. So that might be the reason that I have webbed toes or something like that. Not exactly sure why I chose this area, considering it's not the most attractive place. It's pretty smelly at times. As we start up this episode, I want to let you know that we will be revisiting a few cool little places that I adventured around as a little one. Well, not for too long, just a quick little visit at some of the older WILDerland adventure places, and one very special one in particular. And I'm carrying a very special package with me that we are going to plant and display for all to see with a real cool announcement. So yeah, you guys, it's a beautiful day. What do you say? We get some adventuring. Okay, you guys, so I'm about 15 or 20 miles from the last place that I was at, and this is another place where we filmed quite a few little shorts back in the day. We had filmed two blaps down there a little bit with the GoPro attachment on the inner tube, and over here is where we had filmed the rope swing thing with the GoPro attachment and all, but unfortunately, you guys, there is no more rope swing, nor is there a branch that it was attached to, so I don't know what happened there, but it's gone now. There's that big bass. He was just there. He's got a big old black stripe down his side. I don't have my fly rod with me at the moment, unfortunately. Lots of little creatures. It's nice because it's shallow, clear water on a sunny day. I have got my special thing with... Ooh, look, there's a fence lizard right there. I've got my special thing with me, but I don't feel that this place is the right place that I'm going to plant it, so I'm going to keep moving. Let's just say hi to Philip the fence lizard right here. There he goes. See some of those guys up in Oklahoma. He doesn't want to stick around to play, though. But you guys, let's get moving. Well, how many of you guys remember this one? This one goes way back to when we filmed the first trailer, actually. Well, the only trailer. I think. Yeah, the very first trailer for Alec in Wilderland, the original concept. And we filmed all sorts of stuff in the trailer here. And this was one of them, me pulling myself through the mud. It's a bit dry in this area, so I'm kind of just scraping myself against the ground. But you guys, let's keep looking around and see what else we filmed here. Okay, you guys, so I'm here at another campground where I have actually been to quite a few times. We filmed multiple things here. I'll get a little more into that later. But today's been a pretty crazy day. I've traveled really far, actually. We started the morning in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Pretty far north compared to where we are, actually 600 miles. So we traveled all the way down to southeastern Texas, and that's where we are now. Unfortunately, it's pretty dark out right now, so you guys can't see the big beautiful lake behind me, but I will show you guys that in the morning. But I've got to get setting up camp, and then I'll be heading to bed, and we can start off our adventure fresh in the morning. So you guys, I'll see you in the morning, and good night. Lantana. Okay, you guys, so I've come across a real cool butterfly here. And speaking of butterflies, I mentioned earlier that I was over in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And what I was doing up there was partly because of butterflies. I met this cool guy, his name is Jack. He's training to be a junior naturalist over in Oklahoma. And what we did is we went out and planted a redbud tree, which is the state tree of Oklahoma. But we also planted lots of little seeds that will help to grow milkweed. Now milkweed, if you guys don't know, is very important to the survival of the monarch butterfly population. So check this out, you guys. Guys, so it is a gorgeous day and I'm here with my friend Jack. Now, Jack and I are going to be helping out nature today by planting some milkweed. Jack is a junior naturalist, boy scout, and avid fly fisherman.
So, milkweed, we're going to be planting milkweed today. And what's cool about milkweed is that a lot of other animals, when they eat it, they don't like the taste of it. It's kind of just for the butterflies. But right now, the butterflies are threatened, so by planting more milkweed, we can help increase the population. Some pesticides are killing the milkweed, so butterflies are dying. We chose this area because it's kind of away from the road and there's a lake down there. We're gonna start by turning up the soil, and then we're gonna kinda rake it a little bit to make nice rows and then sprinkle some seeds on.
So these seeds will take about 3 to 4 weeks until they begin to germinate, which is when they'll start to actually turn into plants and bloom and all that. And then they'll grow to a full-grown sized plant in about 60 days. Well, after about 10 minutes of some very hard work, we have finally managed to bury all of the seeds. It was about 15 packets in all. So, you obviously like camping and all that. You're a Boy Scout, you're a junior naturalist. What's your favorite thing to do outside?
I like almost everything outside. I just like being in the outdoors, like adventuring through the woods and seeing what I could find.
So, in most everyone who likes to go outside, there's this thing called the spirit of adventure. And you obviously have the spirit of adventure within you. You like to go exploring, you like to help nature, you like to go fishing, catch animals, all sorts of cool stuff. Why do you think you have the spirit of adventure?
Part of it is because I've never really liked watching TV, and I'm always asking my brother, do you want to go play outside? And he's just, no, I want to stay in here, and I'm tired. And I'm like, well, you got to get out and do something. So I've always been like that.
Sounds a lot like me. Thank you for inviting me out here to help you plant the milkweed and help save the butterflies. So nice job on that. Our job is complete here, and we're going to enjoy the rest of this gorgeous day here in Oklahoma. So if you guys remember, about 2 years ago, we planted this geocache right here, and you can see the effects of nature and irresponsible geocachers over time. So let's take a look at it and see how it has changed. And luckily we brought a replacement, because you guys, I don't feel right putting this one right back out, because if I was a geocacher, I would not want to find it in this state. If we pop it open, you can see there are lots of ants inside. Now the ants are have gone inside because of the ice cream, so whoever put that in there, that's not a very good thing to do. Don't do that. But we are going to replace it. You can see this guy right here. This is a trackable. Now the cool thing about trackables is, as it says in the name, they're trackable. So somebody decided to put this in here, and then someone else might come and find it and move it to a different place. And as it goes, it'll be logged, and you can see where it travels. This one in particular started up in Ohio, went down to Louisiana, went over to northern Texas, then down to the Big Bend area, then back to central Texas, and then down to where the cache is now, so like southeastern Texas. But you guys, we can sort of pull some stuff out. It's starting to sprinkle a bit here. Here's the original logbook. So we're going to take this one that I've got with me here, and we are going to transform it. It's even a little bigger. Look at that, you guys. And this is what a cache should look like. So here we have Malcolm the Millipede, and millipedes are real cool little guys. They're fun to hold because they're smooth and they tickle when they walk. But you might want to know the difference between millipedes and centipedes, because lots of centipedes will sting and bite. The bigger ones are even venomous, so you want to be careful with that. Millipedes tend to have, well, they always have a lot more legs. Like if you sat down to count them, they just have so many it looks like the bottom of them is free because they have so many legs. Whereas centipedes, you're mostly able to count them because you can see them, they're a little more visible. There's fewer of them. Millipedes tend to be a little rounder on their shell, whereas centipedes have a little flatter shell. And millipedes are nice and they do not sting, whereas centipedes, they'll tend to sting you if you try and pick them up. So I was over here rock flipping down by the lake, as you can see. And I found this little skink right here. I think we will name him Saltine after the cracker, because he is being salty as he does not want to be held at the moment. Now he's calming down pretty good. But remember, you guys, when you catch a skink, make sure not to grab it by the tail, because they can detach their tail, and that's never fun for these guys. But you may remember from the Oklahoma episode that I caught lots of skinks when I was rock flipping, and another animal that I caught there just recently were some frogs. But while I was there up in Tulsa recently, I met this cool kid named Derek, and he was working on a project to help the frogs in that region and all over the world, really. So check this out, you guys. What's up, you guys? So I am here in Oklahoma. You can tell it's Oklahoma because of all of the ticks. That's some good memories right there. So here's Derek.
I like to help reptiles and amphibians any way I can, and whenever I grow up, I'd like to try and help with snake anti-venoms. or like field research for snakes and turtles and reptiles. There's a lab for the University of Oklahoma that is studying fungal infections on frogs, so today we're gonna go find some and swab them to see what kind of fungal infection we can find on them. We have our swabs that we can use to swab it, so once we take them out of here, the only thing they can touch is the frogs, and then we put them in these vials, so we'll have to break off the majority of it so it will fit in here. We mark it as frog number whatever, and then we put it in our bag and collect some more. So far I have 5 frogs down at one location, and so today we're looking to try and catch around 10 or so.
And we're just here at this average pond, as you can see. It's there's stores and stuff back there. So yeah, let's go catch some frogs.
Caught 3 frogs, so we're gonna have to set them down in a container while we swab each of the other ones. So, Alec, could you hold that?
Yep.
Should probably set one in the net and just like. They don't have a whole lot of places to go where we can't like chase them down.
Yeah. Oh, jeez.
Okay. We just gotta chase them away. Like. Okay.
Yeah.
Good, nice.
Huge. Huge snake. Sanitizer.
So. Files open. We're gonna swab his sides, both of them 5 times, his belly, his hind legs, and then their webbing. So. Belly and the other legs.
Now, what the fungal infection that is found in some of these frogs is affecting is the keratin. Now, if you guys remember, keratin is also what rhino horn is made out of, and it's also what our fingernails and hair is made out of. And as you can see, this is kind of a luxury to the frog. It's not every day that he gets somewhat of a bath. He's pretty dirty.
I'm gonna label it so that way I know which one it does. We have to take a couple photos of them just to make sure that we identify them correctly.
Cranky. Slapping me. This is frog number 4. Derek was speedy quick and he got this one in about 10 seconds of going back down and after releasing the other ones. All of the frogs that we caught tonight were American bullfrogs and most of them were pretty good size. Okay, you guys, so Derek and I finished up catching frogs and it turned out to be a total of 7 bullfrogs. So here we have one of them here, and he actually found a little garter snake, which is real cool. He's an active little guy. So you obviously have the spirit of adventure inside of you. You love to get outdoors, you love to catch frogs, you just enjoy that all together. What would you say the spirit of adventure is, and why do you have it, whereas some people don't?
I'd say it's wanting to go out and find things in nature, but not destroying a whole bunch of things in that way. And I think I got it because whenever I was little, my aunt owned a pet store, and so whenever I was little, I was around lots of snakes and animals, and that made me like them a lot more than other people might.
Thank you for inviting me to come along on this trip, and I want to thank you for helping to save the future froggies. Okay, you guys, so welcome to another segment of Cooking with Alec. Now, today on Cooking with Alec, we're going to be trying a first, which is cooking a dessert. And this is called a banana magical melt. Now, what we got to do first is open it open. Or open it up. Or open it down, I guess. So, what you want to do is you want to open it like a monkey. So you just pinch the bottom. Just peel downwards. And it's nearly ripe. It'll do, though. It's a bit green yet. We want to take all the peel off. Make sure not to just throw it on the ground because someone could slip, like in the cartoons. Gotta bite the tip of the banana off because that part's gross. Okay, now we're going to take our tin foil and we're going to just set it right there in the middle, smack dab. There's a moth trying to steal my banana milk. There we go. You guys can see there's an opening right there. If you didn't know, if you just break a banana down the center, it splits into 3 different pieces, which is pretty cool. But we're only going to have it split into 2 different pieces today. Now we're going to add our marshmallows. You can have any kind of marshmallows you want. You can have fruit-flavored marshmallows like me. You can have normal marshmallows. You can have caramel marshmallows. You can have Spam-flavored marshmallows. That sounds pretty good right now. But what we're going to do is we're just going to line them up along the middle. Now it's time to add some chocolate chips. Today with me I've got butterscotch chips. You can add any type of chips really, just not potato chips because those will be a bit salty. You can add chocolate chips, you can add butterscotch chips, you can add white chocolate chips, dark chocolate chips, whatever you prefer. But these ones will look the best on camera and they'll be pretty tasty. So just line it up like ants on a log. Now I'm not a big fan of chocolate chips. I don't really like just plain chocolate, but when it's mixed with something, it's pretty good, so I think it might be kind of good on this, but dark chocolate, definitely for me, I don't really like. It's a bit overwhelming and bitter, but I've got all my little ants on a log here, so I can wrap it on up and toss it in. Okay, you guys, so it's been cooking for about 3 minutes now, which might have been a bit too long. I had to move it out of the direct flame, but let's see how it's coming along. May have left it in a little bit too long as the chips did kind of burn a bit, but it's looking good inside the actual banana. We still have a few more ingredients to add. We've got some crushed up peanut butter granola that we can just sprinkle on. You can actually sprinkle quite a few different things on if you want, different types of cereals, just any little thing that you think would make it taste pretty good. And then we've got some maple syrup here. We can just drizzle on to add to it. And it's looking pretty good, so we can give it a taste. I'm gonna go for an end piece here, because it seems like it cooked fairly well. It's a bit hot yet. It's pretty good. It's really sweet. You can taste the maple syrup in the banana, which obviously, because it's the biggest 2 ingredients, I think the marshmallows got a little bit melted off. These ones that are on the bigger side, it might be a little bit better. But other than that, it's pretty good. Can't really taste much of the butterscotch though. But yeah, I think that was overall a success. So thanks for joining me on another episode of Cooking with Alec. Hey you guys! So it is a beautiful day. We actually don't really have too much sun out right now, but it's still pretty nice out. Feels good. There's low wind. But we are here by the waterside along a secluded trail, so it's a beautiful place for fishing. Now you guys, sometimes there's a certain fish that you want to catch and you've got to adjust your tackle accordingly in order to catch it. Because there's a lot of fish in this lake. There's drum, there's catfish, there's bass, there's gar. And if you want to catch a certain fish, you're going to have to try hard to make it appealing to that certain species. And that includes the bait you use, the tackle you use, rod you use, the technique that you use, the area that you fish in, all sorts of stuff. So today we're going to be trying to catch a bass. Now, what I like to do for bass is typically I'll get a shank hook. In this case, I don't really have very good sized shank hooks. I've only got gigantic ones, so that won't work. But I've got one with a hook with barb, so that'll work fine. But I'll just take that, put a worm on it with a little split shot and jig it along the bottom, and typically that'll attract the bass's attention. But the only thing is that here you've got lots of catfish. So catfish, as you guys might know, they feed off the bottom. And because they're so abundant in this area, I'm trying to avoid them. So what I want to do is try and get it either in the middle of the water or the top of the water. So to skip it along the top, or use a bobber to get along the middle, or just to take a weight off and try and reel it in a bit faster. Anything to keep it off the bottom to avoid bottom feeders like catfish and drum. So you guys, I've got my hook here. I'm just going to grab a night crawler, and in my opinion, live bait always works better than fake bait. So today we've got some very lively night crawlers here. We want to take it and we want to feed it all the way up and around, get as much surface area of the worm on there as you can, and then behind we'll drag this tail, and that'll wiggle around in the water, and that will attract the bass. So it'll be a nice little attractive snack for most any fish, but today we will be targeting the largemouth bass. Okay, you guys, so after only about, I'd say 10 minutes or so of fishing, my method actually worked. I did have to switch hooks. As you can see, it's a smaller hook because I got snagged. But all I was doing was just reeling this worm through the water very slowly, and this bass came up and hit it. And he's not a very small bass either. It is a largemouth bass, which is what I was going after. We'll unhook him so you can see him a little better. So some largemouth bass have a little more prominent line, but you can see there's a very faint black line right there. You can tell it's a largemouth bass because its jaw does descend behind the eye. Right now his mouth is open, so you can't really tell. There you can see the jaw goes behind the eye. It's got a very big mouth, as his name says. But yeah, I'd say he's about 7 inches long or so. But we're gonna put her back in the water now, so say bye-bye.
So I am now here in the Gulf of Mexico of Texas, a place where I've filmed multiple times, multiple things. It's where I filmed our first beach episode, and I've actually found lots of cool stuff here. It's where I saw my first wild sea turtles. I just saw a man of war down there. There's lots of those guys. Found my first sand dollar. All sorts of cool little adventures that we've had here. But I am here today to talk to you guys about a cool dude who, since you guys are all on YouTube, you might have heard of him. His name is Atua. Now, Atua lives in the beautiful country of Costa Rica, and he is quite the adventurer. He does all sorts of stuff. He's got beautiful terrain to explore. He preps for a lot of different stuff, because in Costa Rica, occasionally, the power will go out, so he's made showers and all sorts of stuff for his family. He's got little kids, so he's always ready to go. He's like a Boy Scout. He's always prepared. But you guys, I'm gonna give Atua a call real quick to ask him about the spirit of adventure, because as you guys know, I've been asking quite a few people about the spirit of adventure. So I'll just dial him up real quick. 1-800-ATUA.
Alec?
Hey, Atua.
Oh, hey, how's it going, Alec?
So you obviously have the spirit of adventure. You like to go out surfing, you like to go exploring all over the place. You got howler monkeys in your backyard, you go jumping into waterfalls and all sorts of cool stuff.
Yeah.
What do you think the spirit of adventure is, and how do you think some people get it, whereas some people don't?
Yeah, well, what the spirit of adventure means to me is it's kind of like a mindset and kind of like a way of life. It's like, to me, it means it's like you always want to be outdoors and you're like always like curious to just like find out like what's right over there, and you always just want to like explore a little bit further, and like you always want to like learn about other cool things and like see explore around. And it's definitely something, it's not something that everyone's born with, but everyone can develop it. And a good way to develop the spirit of adventure is, if you don't have it, is hanging out with people who already do have it, who do have a spirit of adventure, because if they have it and they're always wanting to like do stuff outside, it'll inspire you and motivate you to maybe want to be more outside and explore and adventure and do fun stuff like that. Like me, I love to just be outside. I always like want adventure. Even if I already know it's there, I'll still want to adventure it over and over again and just see what's over. And I love to just like, people, when you have the spirit of adventure, you like always just like want to be like right in the action and like do it, feeling like you can watch it on a computer, but it's not the same as when you're actually there and like seeing it and like how do I explain that? Just like being in the action and like feeling how cool it is there and the views and stuff. Oh, looks like there's a swell in town. Looks like the waves are firing. I'll catch you later. I'm gonna go get a few good waves while the tide's perfect and there's some nice waves. Catch you later, Alec. Have a good day. Phew.
Okay, you guys, so that was Atua. And for all you guys who aren't subscribed to him, make sure you head over to his channel and check it out, because he's got a lot of cool content. Okay, you guys, so I am still in the Gulf of Mexico, over here in the southern Texas. This area in particular, though, you guys may recognize it. It's a very special area for all of Alec and WILDerland. This is where we filmed multiple things, including the first ever shot scene of Alec and WILDerland. Now, it wasn't the first release scene, but it was the first film scene. So it's a real cool little area to revisit. But you guys, I've been talking to you about the spirit of adventure this whole trip so far. I've asked multiple people about what it means to them. How did I get the spirit of adventure? Well, I think quite a few different things influenced that to make me the way that I am now. One of which includes watching Bear Grylls on TV, watching all the cool stuff that he was able to do, and I really wanted to be more like that, to be able to get outside and find all sorts of cool stuff and survive on my own out in the wild. But I think the biggest influence is that my grandpa always took me fishing when I was little, getting me outdoors, showing me what it was like. I got to interact with all sorts of animals. I had a huge love for pets. I always wanted as many pets as I possibly could. And going outside and exploring and catching animals was kind of like having as many pets as I could find.
So that's kind of what shaped me to have the spirit of adventure within me. I think everybody in the world has the spirit of adventure within them. It's just a matter of whether or not you turn it on. Now, the spirit of adventure doesn't have to be tied down to just getting outside and going exploring and going kite surfing or rappelling or those crazy thrilling sports. It can just be taking chances in life in general, going for something that you don't believe you would get otherwise unless you really put yourself out there, get outside of your comfort zone, and try for something. As you guys know, in my last adventure vlog, we announced that as a show we are going to go on hiatus. It's kind of just take a break and focus on creating something bigger and better for ourselves and for you guys, as well as allowing me to adjust into a normal public schooling life again. But while we were on hiatus, we were able to produce something awesome and fantastic, and what that is a brand new production company. Not only does that allow us to do this show, it allows us to do lots of other shows as well, such as documentaries on other explorers, new short films. We'll have lots of new explorers, new adventures, and even in the future, a brand new mega series. I'm very excited to reveal to you the production company name and logo that we are so proud of. So you guys, how about we get this show on the road? But it also represents any animal in the world. Now, primitive means wild, and planet is the world. So it's a wild world for all of us, and we're all connected. Until next time, you guys, stay wild!